We all know the search for life in the solar system, and on Mars in particular, represents a bit of the holy grail of human exploration in space. Almost every mission that starts with the intent to descend on other worlds is in fact accompanied by an emphasis that is usually reserved only for the noblest enterprises. And this is the sign of how great and widespread is in our species the desire not to feel alone in this great universe. And someone in the upper echelons of NASA and other space agencies must have understood this for a while. So much so that the word life has become the password that more easily than others opens the doors of government grants and captures the attention of an otherwise distracted public. It's nice, in fact, to know that a large state organization like NASA has in its charter a commitment to search for life in the universe. It makes us feel reassured in our beliefs, doesn't it? However, there is one thing that not everyone knows, and that is that the last real interplanetary mission conceived and launched to search for real life on Mars was that of the Viking probes. We are talking about 1976, when the two NASA landers made the only attempt ever to find life on Mars, conducting on-site specific biological experiments in search of evidence of microbial life. Experiments that, by the way, even today, many biologists believe, contrary to what was stated by NASA, have been successful. Since then, inexplicably, despite the fanfare that accompanied the departure of every single Martian mission, none of the subsequent landers or rovers sent by NASA to Mars brought with them an instrument capable of following up on those controversial but exciting results. In short, for nearly half a century now, NASA has pretty much stopped looking for life on Mars. Over the years, it has always continued to claim that the purpose of Martian exploration was to find or disprove life. But in fact, the probes sent were absolutely unable to fulfill the mission for which they were presented to the world. All subsequent missions to Viking were in fact designed to study the Martian environment from the geological point of view, and not to confirm or not that among the sands of Mars there could be microbial life. But not only that, there's also something else that most people who are passionate about space endeavors probably don't know. Although completely unsuitable for the search of life, the Martian rovers have always been absolutely forbidden to get closer than 2.5 kilometers from certain places where life could have had the opportunity to find the best conditions to settle. In practice, while the media was proposing the mantra of "let's go looking for life," the agencies sent on Mars rovers suitable only for geological exploration, and moreover in places absolutely arid and far from the outcropping points of liquid water. The reason? The protocol of planetary protection. The Outer Space Treaty of the United Nations, in fact, since 1967, prohibits the dangerous contamination of other worlds with terrestrial biological forms, and an international organization called COSPAR, Committee on Space Research, establishes protocols for the protection of the planets to which must follow the United States, Europe, Russia, and other signatory nations that are going to travel in space. To protect Mars, since 2002, COSPAR has defined some restricted special regions on the planet, where the temperature and humidity could be sufficient to support the life of Martian organisms or terrestrial invaders. Special regions that have absolutely been identified along the equator and in the mid-latitudes of the planet, in eroded and steep gullies, rocky hillsides, and craters where brackish water flows from aquifers during Martian summers, or in caves under polar ice caps and in geothermal hotspots of seismic or volcanic activity. No human artifacts can approach any of these sites, for fear that the eventual Martian life form may be eliminated or hybridized by terrestrial microbes, and it is precisely to avoid the unintentional export of terrestrial organic material that spacecrafts are carefully sterilized before each launch. It has been ascertained, however, that on our planet there are several microorganisms that can resist even the most ferocious sterilization, as well as the prohibitive conditions of interplanetary space during the Earth-Mars crossing. So much so that it seems that it is not possible to exclude that once arrived on Mars, some bacteria may weaken and find asylum in the most humid and hot areas of the planet. The study, developed by astrobiologist Andrew Schuiger and collaborators at the University of Florida, has in fact verified the survival and reproduction capabilities of some terrestrial microorganisms in a Martian environment stimulated in the laboratory. The bacterial cultures were kept in chambers with pressures of 7 millibars. On Earth at sea level, pressures are around 1,000 millibars. Carbon dioxide-based atmosphere without oxygen. Temperature at 0 degrees Celsius. No humidity. Coming to prove that a common terrestrial bacterium, such as serratia liquefaciens, present on the human body, animals and plants, could take root and multiply even in the hostile environmental conditions of Mars, demonstrating adaptive capacity, even superior to those of other bacteria that live on Earth in extreme conditions, the so-called extremophiles. But if sterilized robots cannot be trusted to venture into special regions, what about humans? NASA is planning to send humans to Mars by 2030, and understandably, the fact that those missions may involve contamination risks is not something the agency wants to highlight, just as it is busy studying possible solutions to the problem. Not the least because it would be difficult to explain to citizens why a human mission costing tens of billions of dollars should be barred from the most promising regions from a biological research perspective. And if a human crew landed in an area deemed unsuitable for life, but discovered habitable conditions or living forms, would they have to move immediately, pick up the rocket, and return to orbit? These and other unanswered questions show how the discovery of a Martian biosphere could be, for different reasons, the realization of NASA's greatest dream or its worst nightmare. Until now, the planetary protection of Mars has been about robotic exploration. The risk of contamination is also an issue for machines, but unlike humans, they can't tolerate being irradiated and flooded with harsh chemicals before launch to destroy clandestine bacteria. Under these assumptions, however, planetary protection would come to exclude the human exploration program entirely, and all the scientific convenience that might follow. And if applied 60 years ago, it would have wrecked even the historic moon landings. Let's not forget that those early astronauts left several hundred kilograms of metabolic waste at six different sites on the lunar surface. That is dozens of bags of excrement, urine, vomit, and food waste. Besides making the most historic feat of human exploration seem more like the next day of a student party, the point is that those waste products could have contaminated thousands of microbial species. Who's to say that at least one of them didn't manage to find its own niche in which to reproduce? After all, even the astronauts of the Apollo 12 mission found bacteria on the moon, surviving a near vacuum inside the robotic lander Surveyor 3, which landed on the planet more than 2.5 years earlier. If terrestrial microbes can live in places like that, why not in some of the more habitable parts of Mars? Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Unbeknownst or not to the general public, the application of this principle of caution has been carried out scrupulously over the decades, partly because there has always been a belief, perhaps illusory, that they could actually sterilize equipment and rovers sent into space. Now that the human component is about to come back into play, however, it becomes impossible to meet the same standards. However clean and sanitized it may be, the human body is loaded with bacteria that risk making it impossible to carry out a mission, at least according to previous guidelines. NASA has therefore addressed the issue by downgrading some areas of the moon, but not Mars, in order to raise the tolerance limits against human contamination. Specifically, the moon is now classified almost entirely as a Category 1 body, where no protection is required since no life forms are expected to be found, while previously it was classified as a Category 2 body, remote possibility that contamination by terrestrial means could compromise future missions. This category had been assigned following the formulation of hypotheses regarding the existence of water masses in an icy state on the moon. While it is now applied only to a few very specific sites in which there are shadowed craters that might harbor icy areas, most of the moon thus becomes more easily explored. Regarding Mars, instead, no modification. The whole planet has been confirmed Category 4 body. High risk of contamination. with some specific areas even more protected. A policy so restrictive that makes us raise more than one suspicion on the possibility that Viking actually found Martian life half a century ago, and that NASA or whoever wanted to keep the discovery a secret. Okay, maybe that's a fantasy. What instead is real is the rise of a part of the scientific community that declares itself absolutely in disagreement with NASA's overly cautious policy, and fights for the space agency to vary less strict guidelines, compatible both with the protection of a possible Martian ecosystem and with the legitimate explorative aspirations of future human missions. When Earth sends astronauts to Mars, they will travel with life support and energy supply systems, habitats, 3D printers, food, and tools. None of these materials can be sterilized in the same way that systems associated with robotic spacecraft can. Human colonists will produce waste, try to grow food, and use machines to extract water from the soil and atmosphere. Quite simply, by living on Mars, human colonists will contaminate Mars. In a recently published article, microbiologist Jose Lopez argues that efforts to enforce planetary protection provisions are actually completely unnecessary, and perhaps even very naive. Mars and Earth, in fact, must have been contaminating each other for billions of years now through the mutual exchange of meteoritic material. Rather than worrying about contamination, Lopez and his co-authors argue instead that we should deliberately send our germs into space and that the spread of our microbes should be part of a larger colonization strategy to change the Martian climate and environment. In practice, in the article, the authors are convinced that it may be impossible to prevent our germs from invading the places we are exploring, and that it would be therefore much more rational to start discussing how to use microorganisms to our advantage, rather than run the risk of putting a brake on colonization for too much caution. In short, the situation is really difficult, but among the many uncertainties, one thing is very clear. The implementation of the provisions of planetary protection due to send astronauts to Mars will raise huge questions between science, engineering, technology, project management, and public policy. Not to mention the ethical issue, which must be considered as the root cause of all this reluctance to consider the solar system bodies as new territories of our complete relevance. Carl Sagan, well-known astronomer and popularizer, claimed that if life was ever found on the fourth planet, then Mars should belong only to the Martians, even if they were only microbes. In this perspective, the planet would be considered an untouchable sanctuary, forbidden forever to the human species. A display of ethics completely acceptable, but to stand in its motivations should, however, first confront another holocaust, that of hundreds of billions of sentient beings killed every year on Earth for our food vices. Why do Martian microbes deserve to live and our animals don't? Meanwhile, the Perseverance rover is about to descend on the Red Planet. And even in this case, the main purpose of the mission will not be to rummage through the brackish water springs and analyze with chemical reagents the presence or absence of microbial life. No, the task of the rover will be to collect samples of Martian soil, collected strictly outside the special regions, and leave them in the sand in large tubes waiting for other probes to come to take them to Earth. Do you know when? In 10 years. What do you think? Doesn't it seem to you that NASA is just trying to stall?